return on assets and is levered 10 to 1, the return on equity is 10%. That's the simple formula. So, you know, Citigroup, for example, doesn't even have a 1% ROA, but they're not that far off. So Deutsche Bank today has a 30 basis point ROA. They need to improve their profitability by more than three times. There's no way Deutsche Bank on its own can improve its profitability three times. The entire European banking system has to reprice. You know, how that's going to ever happen, I don't know. But until it does, European banks are going to be a problem.
They're going to be a problem. So you've been in here in London for a few hours now, and you must have realized already that the only thing people talk about here is Brexit.
Yes.
So what financial risk do you see coming from Brexit?
That's a big
That's a
question.
big
That's a
question. Okay,
biggie.
what will happen in March?
I have no idea.
You have no
I
idea.
really have no idea,
Yeah.
honestly. I don't think, and more importantly, I don't think anybody else has any idea.
No.
It's going to be an adventure. I don't know, it's going to be a fun adventure, but it's going to be an adventure.
So you said that we're very bad at dealing with crises that develop very slowly, and you know, you put the blame on the big financial crisis of 2007, 2008 on income distribution, really. Do you see that changing at all? I mean, it's
Well, let me explain that,
yeah.
because it's not intuitively obvious how the two are connected. So, you know, my thesis is that one of the underlying causes of the financial crisis was bad income distribution. So, you know, when I say that, people's eyes generally glaze over, like, you know, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
But I think that there's a cause and effect relationship in that, you know, starting in the 90s when income distribution started to get really poor, you know, the United States, rather than focus on that and what the solutions were to that problem, let credit get democratized. That was the euphemism for we'll make loans to people that we didn't make loans to before. So rather than get people's incomes up, they let them lever themselves. And one of the ways people levered themselves was by taking out loans on their homes and levering themselves that way. And so I think one of the causes of the subprime mortgage crisis is that. You know, post Dodd-Frank, it's hard to get a mortgage loan.
Yeah.
You know, incomes have only started to start growing again. We'll have to see what if this new administration can do anything.
So with Dodd-Frank, it's harder to get a loan, but
Well, no,
as you
it's
said,
harder to get a mortgage
mortgage
loan,
loan.
although I don't think that's a cause and effect of Dodd-Frank. I think it's more of an effect of all the fines that were imposed on the banks for the mortgage crisis. And so the banks, I think not ju unjustifiably, are kind of wary about making mortgage loans that they might not should or should not make.
So the financial crisis, would you say the main problem was the products, the tools available, or the culture?
I would say, you know, here's one of the unsung aspects of the financial crisis that people have definitely not written up about, which is psychology.
Yeah.
And what I mean by psychology is you have an entire generation of Wall Street executives who grew up in the 90s and the early aughts who really only had one experience, which is they made more money every single year. Now, what they didn't really notice was as they were making more money every single year, the leverage of their various institutions was increasing every single year. Now, they thought they were making more money because it was them, but really what was happening is they were making more money because their institution was becoming more levered. And really what happened was they mistook leverage for genius. I wrote that sentence, by the way.
You wrote that sentence,
I
by the
did.
way.
It's a good
Yeah,
sentence.
it's a good sentence.
I don't write a lot of good sentences, but that's definitely one of
That's
them.
tweetable.
Yes, it's very good. Very
Yeah.
if I tweeted, I would
You
tweet
would
it.
tweet that, yeah.
So if let's imagine you went to a Wall Street executive in circa 2006, and you said to the CEO of, you know, pick the name of your institution, and you'd say, dude, listen, the entire paradigm of your career is wrong. You have to delever.
So, did you ever have a conversation like that?
I did. I've never told this story before. This is like a now it can be told story.
Okay.
So the date is February 2008, and I have a meeting with the head of risk management at one of the big Wall Street firms. We won't name the name of the company.
Name them.
But it wouldn't matter because I would have had the same, it would have been the same conversation with any of them given what the discussion was. So I sit down with the head of risk management of one of the big firms. It's 1 month before Bear Stearns, almost to the day.
Okay.
And I say to him, you have got to delever, and you've got to delever now because Armageddon is coming.
That's Did you use a, the word it's Armageddon?
Almost, it's almost a direct quote, and I use the word Armageddon.
Okay.
And he looks at me and he says, you know, I hear what you're saying, but you know, we at X, we can be much more levered than a bank. Mm. Now, back then, there was a bank based in Detroit called Nat City. It was a medium-sized regional bank, and it had a lot of subprime mortgages, so it was a bit of the topic of the day. And so I said to him, you know, do you know what happens if Nat City goes down? And he says, no, what happens? I said, nothing. So the regulators come in, they seize the bank, they pay off the depositors, they fix the bank, they sell the bank, the government takes something of a loss, end of story. Do you know what happens if your firm goes down? Planet Earth burns. Who should be more levered? And he looked at me like I was speaking ancient Greek.
Right.
Like he just, it was so outside his paradigm. It's like he didn't know what he was talking about. And I realized it was over. That there was no way these guys were going to do what needed to be done before the world blew up.
Mm. But at least we're going to see some of them go to jail. Right? I mean, they're going to have to break up the banks.
I mean, the party's over.
I don't know. I have a feeling that in a few years, people are going to be doing what they always do when the economy tanks. They will be blaming immigrants and poor people.
Is that an actual quote from you or is that Hollywood?
It's a great quote. It's not mine.
It's not yours.
It was written by Adam McKay, who was the author and director of the movie.
But did you think in those terms back then?
Oh, I always think in those terms.
You always think in terms of disaster?
Yes.
Why is that?
It's just, I have a very strange DNA.
Right. Do you see this paradigm changing at all, this culture?
Oh, it's totally changed.
It's totally changed.
They've been
way?
Beaten to a pulp.
Yeah.
You know, the Dodd-Frank gave much more power to the Fed to regulate the banks. That power was put in the hand of Governor Daniel Tarullo, and I think he's done a tremendous job of delevering the banks in the United States. You know, I would say the CEOs of the banks fought him kicking and screaming, but I'd say in the last year or two they gave up.
Mm. And I know you said before that Europe's done not as good of a job with that.
That's correct.
Why?
Well, it's what's your starting point. So, you know, just pre-crisis, Citigroup is levered 35-1. Deutsche Bank is levered over 50-1. So today, Citigroup is levered 10-1. And Deutsche Bank, depending on how you calculate, is probably levered 25-1. So everybody's leverage is lower. European banks have always been much more levered than US banks. So they're still more levered. They're just less levered than they were.
Mm. Right.
So they're not delevered enough to my taste.
Yes.
But that's, again, that gets back to the problem of they're not profitable enough per dollar employed. So the regulators in Europe let them be more levered. I think it's a mistake, but that's the way the system here works.
Mm. Okay. And everyone's asking you what the next financial crisis is going to be. So
oh, I don't have a next financial
I know,
crisis.
And I'm not going to ask you one. It's enough.
I mean, everybody, you know, when people ask me that question, I say, you know, everybody's trying to pick the next Big Short, and I've done that already, and I'm in no rush.
Okay. Thanks a lot, Steve Eisman.
Thank you.